Okay, yeah, so like I said, unboxing. I just wanted to like do kind of like a pretend unboxing so y'all could unbox the goods here with me in a way, since they're gonna be locking us up all over again, so we might not see each other probably ever, 'cause like end of the world vibes. So I got a camera strapped to my head via an ingenious headband device. This is probably the worst way of doing this, but it's my way. So like, let's get it. So right here is the high grades 1 to 144 scale Gundam Barbatos or Barbatos, depending on your preferred pronunciation. This is the Gundam that is featured in the Iron-Blooded Orphans Mobile Suit Gundam series that was released in 2015 and ran for about 50 episodes. It's a good show, excellent show. Recommend that shit highly. Here we have the Gundam in question, Barbatos, I think is the closer pronunciation to the Japanese, in a fighting stance with weapons equipped, giant mace, and really cool katana looking thing strapped to the back of it. Right over there, eyes glowing green. He's a cool dude. You'll get to see him in a bit. Just to give you a little overview of what's going on the box here, because there's like some excellent some symbology, iconography, etc., that we can like get to familiarize ourselves with in the realm of Gunpla. Gunpla being a portmanteau of Gundam and Pla, which is itself a portmanteau of plastic and modeling. So it's like a triple portmanteau. There you go. Yeah, so common to all of these boxes sets, or to most of them, I should say, is the Bandai logo here. It's changed over time, but it's always present. The manufacturer, producer, and owner of Gundam, I believe. I think they since like 89 or the 90s or some shit, they decided to just buy it up and make that source of revenue their very own by what did I do? Yeah, that's some anime history details that I'm not exactly fully brushed up on. Another cool element here that we should be paying attention to is this little symbol here. Not sure how visible that is. It says HG, and it has like a little subtitle that says Iron-Blooded Orphans. HG here stands for high grade. That's the classification of this Gundam model, which sort of separates it from other such models. In terms of both build quality and the scale of the model being represented, so you can get them in other classifications. There's the RG line. It stands for real grade, master grade line, and perfect grade line. It sort of like goes up in terms of quality and pricing. The HG, despite its somewhat misleading name, high grade is in fact the entry level for Gundam plastic modeling. Therefore, the cheapest and most more likely to take shortcuts in terms of quality. But we'll get into that. What else do we see here? This is the logo for the show, Iron Blooded Orphans. That's included on the box as well, just to keep you informed of like what you're dealing with here. Name of the Gundam, the scale model. Over here we see like some copyright information. I'm guessing most of this is in Japanese. What's most important is the date over here. From what my research has taught me, the newer these models are, the better they are in quality overall. So it's worth checking when your kit is from. This is my very first kit, so I'm not too concerned about the date all that much. Looking at the side of the box here, we get a little overview of the poses that you can put your Gundam in. Some cool action poses over here, and there's a little action base that is like plopped right into the perineum of our Gundam, making it appear to fly. Pretty cool, actually. Here's a little couple of shots of the backpack that is included with our Gundam. This is where the weapons are stored, and a thruster is also present. You'll be having a closer look at that. It's a little detail of the footwork, foot action going on here. Cool pose, and a little option for customization. This little box here shows us that like this set comes with some sold separately. Some sold separate pieces, such as the wicked gauntlets that it is equipped with, and these green shoulder pieces. These were not included in my kit. Not too concerned about these extra items either, because I think the gauntlet is kind of corny. And the shoulder pads being green, I don't even recall those from the show. So I'm curious what that's about. What's on this side of the box? Let's see if I can get a little bit more light on here. Hopefully that is visible. That is visibly okay. Okay, visibility. No, I can't see shit. Okay, that's better, I think. Yeah, here we have like a little snippet from the box art, as well as the designation once more of HG. This being part of the high grade line. I think the only new information to be found on this side of the box is the number in the line that this appears in, sort of the. This is the first production model in the Iron-Blooded Orphans HG line. That's what the number 1001 stands for. And there's a little box over here compelling us to check out Bandai-Hobby.net. We're not gonna fall for that. What's on this side of the box, actually? This is a lot more interesting. Over here, we've got another shot of the Barbados, of course, as well as a little profile including a picture of the pilot of the Barbatos. This is Mikazuki August. This is the pilot of the Barbatos throughout the entire series. If I recall correctly, no one else actually gets into Barbados and like and drives it around. He's a little psychopath, but that's why we love him. Well, like him, I guess. I'm not too crazy about Mikazuki in terms of Gundam protagonists. He differs somewhat from the protagonists that I prefer in being a not angsty enough. He's certainly a traumatized young boy, as many Gundam protagonists are. But his version of trauma turns into more a straightforward righteous violence, rather than like soul searching and general angstiness and sort of inward violence, like some of my more beloved Gundam protagonists. There's a little box here. It says story over there, so I'm guessing this is a little overview of the Iron-Blooded Orphans story somewhat. We've got the credits here for the illustrator of the box art and the background image, thanks to Koma and Saito Yoshinobu. Great work, guys. And a little barcode here. This kit was sent to me from France, if I recall correctly, which would explain the inclusion of the word nerf over here. That is neither English nor Japanese. This side of the box is similar to, it's identical to the other side of the box, the opposite side. Let's put this back down. Let's put it back in the right side up. Mess with the lamp a little bit. And yeah, open her up. Yeah, so of course, like everything in here is pretty well rifled through because I've in fact completely assembled the Gundam in question. It was a very good time, and I'm gonna show you what these parts actually, how these parts actually show up and how they're removed from their little runners. These are called runners. This is a blue runner. It contains about three or four parts. They're real small. You grab your wire clippers like so, and you give them a little squeeze, 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 and they pop out with like a very satisfying snap. And you put them together with a whole bunch of other ones, like and the yellow pieces, for example. There's a fair few more yellow pieces in this assembly than there are blue ones. There are some red ones as well. But the main color scheme of the Gundam Barbatos includes a white and the black inner frame. Those are the most prominent colors in the build. Here we have a sheet of stickers. These were a lot of fun, varying amounts of fun. Some were quite frustrating, actually. But that's a form of fun. It's like fun that hurts, fun that hurts you. Which can be fun. Yeah, I'll let you think about that and let you mull that over. Black is the color of the inner frame and most of the inner frame parts of the Gundam Barbatos. There are two runners of black, and they make up the weapons and the inner frame, which we're gonna have a peek at. And white makes up a lot of the armor of the Barbatos, which is accented with pink highlights. The pink highlights mainly coming from the stickers here. We've got an instruction manual. This is the front of the instruction manual, which shows us once again the weapons included in the set. And there's the katana, giant mace and like a targe is how I would describe that, sort of like a tiny shield that is like affixed to your arm, like a targe, right? Shot of the backpack, some action shots over here, and here we have a color guide. This is to inform us of what kind of paints you would require in order to like modify your Gundam with the appropriate painting. So as you can see over here, this is all in Japanese, but it'll tell you just what kind of colors you need to like mix together to get the right hue to touch up your Gundam. Opening up the should we have a look at the back first? Yeah, hell yeah. We got a couple of extra shots of our boy Mikazuki, and I think some additional details pertaining to the Gundam itself, as well as the pilots. Here are some details that we can discern. The Gundam itself, IRL values. This is 18 meters tall. And 28.5 tons, 28.5 tons is the weight of our Gundam. That's how much it weighs. It's a big boy. Yeah, it's a real big boy. Just imagine that. It's 1 to 144 scale, so basically that means if you were to stack 144 of these models on top of each other, you'd have an idea of how tall the actual Gundam is. I keep saying actual Gundam as if Gundams were real. They're not, sadly. They're real in fiction. Real fictitious. One day though. Looking at the inside of our manual, you're treated to a wealth of Japanese, a little couple of warning disclaimers over here that I was not able to heed because my knowledge of Japanese is limited. But as long as you're approaching this device, this assembly with care, caution, and patience, I think you'll be okay in terms of safety. Also, don't put any of these pieces in your mouth, and if you have to, don't swallow. There are some special instructions over here that are supplemented with a little bit of English. These symbols here are like special instructions that show up throughout the manual, telling you to do certain things or pay attention to certain things. Some general advice over here in terms of cutting out your pieces. You want to make sure that no nubs appear on your pieces because that might throw off the connecting parts and make it so connections aren't as solid as they can be. They also warn you not to crush any of the PC parts because they're made of a softer plastic. I forgot to include a little shot of the PC parts. These are poly caps. And they're little balls and sockets made of a softer plastic than the other runners over there. They function as the joints in your Gundam, basically. It's pretty cool. And the texture of them is pretty pleasing, too. We have a parts list over here. This shows us how the parts are numbered and where they can be found on each runner. Let me grab one of these guys again. As you can see, or maybe you can't, depending on the quality of this recording, each one of the runners. Are numbered. Each one of the parts are numbered on the runner. That's a 9 over there. 9, 10, 11, 12, you know how numbers go. And that gives us a handy indication of what we need, and that's how we're going to follow the guide to put our stuff together and create a Gundam. That's where the magic happens. The instructions over here are almost entirely pictorial. There are some instances where some instructions appear with text. Usually these sort of denotes like pay attention to this step, make sure the orientation of the pieces you're working with is correct. We start at the heads. Oh no, we start at the body, then we move on to the head, the right arm, the left arm, the legs. Here we have the right leg and the left leg. Nothing too interesting. Just step-by-step instructions. It's real nice to just put your brain on autopilot and just follow orders for a good couple of hours per sitting, and just ignore what is going on outside. just Gundam it up. Oh, I forgot to mention this box over here that's included in the manual. This is an order form for parts that are missing, but as you can see, this is for customers in Japan only. So if you're outside of Japan, be extra careful putting your Gundam together, because new parts might be much harder to come by. On the back of the manual, we have a couple of pages in color with instructions. Some color instructions, which is pretty dope. It makes me wonder why the entire booklet isn't in color. But I guess that's what they're used to over in Japan, you know, in terms of manga and stuff. You give them a couple of color pages and the rest is in black and white. Maybe that's just what they're accustomed to. Don't give them too many color pages, you know. Otherwise, they might start making some unreasonable demands on the printer, such as giving manga artists decent wages and not working them to death. Over here, we have a little optional swap out option that we can do over here. This is basically just another advertisement for extra shit that you can get your Gundam, like a rifle. I don't have that though. Here we've got another optional piece. I do have this one. The Gundam Barbatos includes two arm options. This is one of the arms over here. I'll show you the other arm in a bit and talk about the differences between them. This is where the instruction comes to an end, and then the final pieces to putting your Gundam together is the shoulder plates, or the pauldrons, I guess you could call them. Let's have a look at the Gundam. Where did I put that? Yeah, that's my boy. This is probably not the best angle for checking him out, so I'm gonna go into like a freehand view, and maybe even turn on the lights back here so it looks a little less spooky.